All right, what's up, guys, and welcome back to another episode of Fab with Matt. I'm your host, Aaron, and as always, this is the Matt in Fab with Matt.
Hey, guys, how's it all going?
it's been
good, eh?
It's been an exciting couple of weeks, set. I think. We've got a new set. We talked about it for so long. It has landed. Monarch is here, which is what we're actually here to talk to you about today. So
yeah,
on our last video, we went over some of our spicy picks for cards in Limited and touched a little bit on
Constructed as well. I think we went over a lot of the Monarch spoilers that were out at that point and sort of touched on our favorite cards and what format we thought they were going to be used in, I think.
Yeah. And I think from our discussions, you guys might have realized that both Nick and Matt were excited about the shadow cards. And that did not change.
No. Well, specifically change.
Yeah, specifically change.
That did not change at all. The chain decks, the shadow cards, the way they play and stuff, that is very much me. Shadow chain to me feels like a Necropotence deck from Magic, you know, where, you know, you could pay all this life to have all these extra cards and then like kind of set up to do these crazy turns, but also just be able to kind of mid-range and out value by like having more cards than they have as well. And, you know, there's just like in every sort of way, you can nickel and dime, you can go crazy, you can kind of just block up and then just play, you know, free cards that aren't taking up whole cards and kind of outvalue them that way. It's literally exactly how I like to play card games.
We have also seen, I think, in the history of just TCGs in general, decks that offer a ton of different decision trees and stuff, if you can play them optimally, generally tend to be really, really good.
Yeah,
and
when you're banishing, very rewarding.
Yeah. And when you're banishing a ton of cards and giving yourselves a ton of options in terms of ways you want to play out the turn and the game, it's just going to lead to some broken stuff, which you and Nick have found.
Yeah. but it's also just so interesting and like a great way to play a card game. When you have these massive different decision trees and all of these different things that you can do in a turn or that you can set up for next turn, or that you're like, okay, this is what I'm going to be doing three turns down the track. Like, it makes for games that just will never get boring. I could play 100 games of chain, you know, yeah. And I don't think I would get bored of it because there's so many different decisions going on.
Yeah. Things can get a little stale if you're just doing something that's just so repetitive, you never change, there's no decisions, it's just do this.
Yeah,
do
this. Charge, things. Charge, counter, shoot.
Yeah.
Induction dash. Chamber, charge, counter, shoot, unmovable, sink below, block you, charge, get another induction chamber, counter. Yeah.
That is not the world we live in anymore.
Oof.
Monarch has been released, and today we have a particularly spicy video for you. This weekend, Matt is going down to play in a... So we're recording this on the Friday before the event.
Yeah.
And it's the Dice Jar... It's actually a double
Dice
weekend,
Jar,
right?
Championships. Yeah. No, not anymore. It was going to be a double weekend with first edition sealed, but with the delays, the product didn't quite make it in time. So it's now... But it's Dice Jar's Championship. So they do this every year. I won last year's one, which was for an Arcane Rising booster case. So I'm defending champions. I had to go down and play. Well, I mean, I didn't have to, but certainly want to. Dice Jar is an awesome store. The owner is super passionate about the community. That store is just great. I love playing at Dice Jar. So if I have an excuse to nip down to Dunedin and play a tournament, I'll take it. So this is this year's championship, they always put up a nice spicy prize. Last year it was a first edition case of Arcane Rising, and yeah, you know, even then those cases were big money. And this year they saved a case of Crucible of War for it. So we're playing for a full case of Crucible of War. So it's a real cool prize. So I've put in a decent amount of effort in the background for this tournament, come up with a deck that I think is just, I mean, for lack of better words, broken.
It's broken.
We've broken it.
But you went through, checked out. And I actually think, like, you touched on that. I know you, Matt has, and Nick have been putting in some serious hours in terms of the testing already for Classic Constructed. And that's
Well, I mean, we haven't actually played any games. we've put in work, you know, talking and theory crafted and stuff. We haven't really played any games. I mean, Nick and I haven't. For this deck, I've been building and refining and testing the list with Nick Butcher, my usual testing partner and all around genius, controversial figure that everybody knows. And then Rohan. Rohan is somebody that's quite known in New Zealand. He won one of the skirmishes last season. He came ninth at the Calling.
He did top eight nationals last year as well.
So Rohan's somebody that's had consistent, pretty good finishes. He lost to me in the finals of one of the Road to Nationals last year as well. He's had plenty of success in this game, and pretty good mind for this thing. So we've been kind of throwing ideas back and forward with Chain, and you know what we think the games play out like, and what should be this and what should be that. And I haven't really had any time. I've been so busy, I haven't had any time to really play games. So Rohan's actually been playing games on TTS with a couple of his mates and kind of reporting back to me, this is how this idea is playing out. So we're sort of, between the three of us, I think we've come up with a pretty masterful deck.
Okay, cool. And I do think events like this do warrant the effort being put in.
For sure.
Like, there's been a lot of talk about first edition product and this and that, and we're not even going to touch on any of that. But the fact that there is a store that literally set aside a case specifically for filling all their other orders, but specifically they could have sold it, they could have done whatever with
it.
They've saved it to support such an awesome event like this. And it's these kind of events that really have been setting Fab aside. Like, clearly, LSS is supporting high-level play.
Yeah.
And when you have stores chipping in on their own back. Yeah. So, massive shout-out to Dice Jar.
Their phrase is for players by players. And you know, that continuously rings true with events like this. You know, Greg, the owner, is just constantly looking out for his community and his players, and he really does a good job. Yeah. So he deserves a shout out there.
Round of applause for Greg. But I reckon we get stuck into it. We've got a deck tech. Matt is gonna walk you guys through the deck. So the card choices from all the choice of blood debt playables to power cards and blues, and sort of how he's sideboarding and reasons for the equipment and all sorts. So
yeah, I'm gonna try to make it pretty in depth. I'll lay out the whole deck, and then I'll talk a little bit about it, how the game plan goes, and then I'll also just start laying out sections and going through section by section. I'm gonna cover every single card in this deck. There's probably a particular card I might cover more than once. there's a certain card in the deck that I just absolutely love, but I'll cover every card in the deck, and we'll try to talk about every, you know, sort of the reasons behind each thing and what they do. So we're going to go for a real in-depth look for you. Cool.
Let's get stuck in.
Let's do it.
All right, guys, and here is the deck. Here is the powerhouse itself. So this is what I've come to. I'm just trying to squeeze it all on here, so it's not super easy to make out, but I'll explain it. I'll take it away, and I'll show it in parts shortly as well. So, the main thing is we got six equipment and one weapon. Six equipment including one weapon. So there's only really one sideboard equipment here, and it's crown for when we need the null room one, which is mostly against the mirror or any other rune blade deck. So initially I was playing Findell's Spring Tunic, realized that I actually bring in Carrion Husk in pretty much every single matchup. Like, I mean, except for Wizard, except for Kano, I'm bringing in the Husk. So I decided that the Tunic wasn't worth the slot, because the Husk actually, even in the mirror, Aurora was fantastic because they're always, you know, trying to get you with things like Plunder Run or Howl from the Beyond and such. And this is just such, you know, six life is so much. So yeah, these are the sideboard cards here. So I'm playing 65 cards minimum main deck. So this is a deck that wants to play more than 60 cards because you are banishing a massive amount of your deck throughout the game. So I'm playing 65 card base, and then I bring in some of these sideboard cards as well. Most matchups I play around the 70, often more than 70 as well. So anything where I think my seeds are going to get through and I'm going to hit some arcane damage here and there, I'm going to play the meet and greets in the third rip through reality. Basically the time snap potions here are for the prism decks. So if they play the I can't remember what it's called because I always call it magnet, but the six cost aura that forces me to attack it. I want to play time snap potion so that in the early game I can just block them and muck around, try to get out a time snap, and once time snap's in play, I never have to worry about magnet again. And also just against any of their auras, just being able to pop time snap, hit the aura, and then carry on with your turn. Pretty handy. And then I've got existence here for against decks where, again, I just really need to turn on the rips. You know, if they've got Null Rune 1 out and they're pitching, often they can turn off a lot of my seeds and my rune chance and like little ways to do damage and whatnot. And then Invert is also just amazing against light decks in general and just very good against Levire as well, so just for kind of messing with their math and messing with what they're trying to do. So Invert comes in quite a lot, and then I've just got this one little Seeping Shadows here. Now Seeping comes in most matchups, but it's still a sideboard card because I don't want to play it against super aggressive decks that are going to be forcing my hand a lot of the time, because if I banish this early, it's just going to cost me too much life. But most of the time I'll bring it in because the one-off just allows my late game to do the full combo. So if I can get to a point where I have about 7 soul shackles, I'm wanting to hopefully get to that point on, you know, with a husk in play and a little bit of life and stuff, and I can just sort of take damage and then come back for a massive turn with Seeping, you know, things like Shadow Puppetry, Seeping, and Snatch, and just try to do a whole lot of things in one turn. So a bunch of go again. Let's dive into sort of parts of the deck. So I'll pull these out. Obviously we know the sideboard here. I'll leave that kind of to the side. I'm gonna pull the cards out and I'm gonna just kind of go into depth on a few more of the things, a few more of the specifics of this. So okay, so basically we got our equipment here. So we're playing chain. I think a big point of contention and something that I haven't seen in other chain decks so far is Nebula Blade. So Nebula Blade is fantastic. It kind of does everything that you want to do. So if you start the turn with some sort of non-attack action like you usually do, your deck's about half. I think we're playing 32 non-attack actions. So almost half the deck. So you're generally going to have one most turns. If you start the turn with a non-attack action and then you make your chain token and come in with Nebula Blade, straight away they have to make some pretty hard decisions on how the rest of your turn is going to play out. You know, if they two card block this, they could really be in a lot of trouble if you then, you know, later on in the turn play a snatch and give it go again and draw a card. So Nebula Blade puts them in a lot of awkward spots, and if they don't block it, you're making a rune chant and your first attack is going to pop that rune chant and turn on your if you've dealt arcane damage matters base cards. So Nebula kind of does everything that you're trying to do in this deck, and it's also quite good in the early game when you're blocking as well. Just that, you know, you can just randomly play a seeds that hits your banish just so that you can come in for four kind of force their hand in the turns where you're blocking with like three cards and just pitching one, you know, while you're building up. Because the way this deck wants to work is generally in your first four turns you want to be blocking them, and once you get up to about five Soul Shackles, that's when you really want to be attacking. So if they're having any big turns in the first four turns, feel free to just throw your whole hand at them, block with anything that you can, and just try to keep your life total high for when you've got a lot of Soul Shackles, so that you've got the life to pay for blood debt. So Nebula Blade just hits a little bit harder. The other blades are three attacks, so if you do them in the middle of the chain, people can just block with one card and then get to figure out what they're going to do later on. This one here requires a bit more decision making on your opponent's side, whether they block with a card and an equipment and then don't have it for snatch, or whether they block with two cards and potentially don't have blocks for snatch there. So this card just combos with snatch really, really well. So the other equipment, Carrion Husk, is just ridiculous. Like, I've realized this card does so much for this deck in getting to its late game. The extra six life here just matters far more than Tunic, far more than pretty much any equipment I've ever played. This card is very, very powerful. So I just want it in every matchup. Grasp of the Arknight. I'm not making a huge amount of rune chant tokens, but it is nice because I do play I think 28 blues. So I am quite a blue heavy deck, because in the late game, what I'm wanting to do is basically just draw as many blues as I can and play all the things from my banish. I don't need to draw red powerful cards because I banish those. So I want to be heavy blue, which does lead to a lot of spots where I've got extra resources, and just being able to make a rune chant here, very handy. So also the block two block one is great as well. So Gives me a bit of a fridge here. Snapdragon Scalers, we all know Snapdragon Scalers, fantastic equipment. It's specifically great on in those late game turns when I'm trying to finish. If I want to try to get play two Riftbinds in one turn after playing a bunch of non-attack actions, Snapdragon just, allows me to do that one massive turn. So you do have to be careful with Snapdragons. You don't want to just throw it away on a snatch mid game, even though a lot of the time you're going to be tempted to. Having this card in play for later on in the game is just huge for you. It means that you're going to be able to do some crazy turns that completely switch momentum on them. So they can be on, you know, 30 something life and you're getting down, you know, you're blocking with this and going down to sort of 15 mark or whatever, but Snapdragons can allow you to do such a powerful sort of 25 odd damage turn that really swings the momentum back around. So it's when you get to that sort of six Soul Shackles that you really need to swing the momentum, because if you're still blocking when you're at six or seven Soul Shackles, you're just going to take too much damage from Blood Debt. So that's kind of how you want to maneuver this. Ebon Fold is fantastic equipment. Obviously, it allows you to banish a lot of the cards that you're just going to play from your banish anyway. So it's kind of a, you know, one resource, draw a card. And it also has the Spell Void 2, which can be, can be a little bit life-saving in some matchups like Kano. So I actually don't even bring in the Arcane Barrier against Kano. I just try to have the Spell Void to try to nullify them a little bit there. Kano's a very hard matchup though. It really depends on kind of how your deck gets going. But I think that Kano is a deck that cannot compete with the other decks in the format now. I think that Kano is going to get hated out by pretty much everything else. So I'm not feeling like I need to overly prepare for that matchup. I would rather be in a spot where I have 74 cards for my deck so that I can play a big deck in all of the other matchups and yeah, basically be fully prepared. The crown is mostly for the mirror. So Arcane Barrier 1, really handy if I need to turn off all of their arcane damage and stop their rip through realities gaining go again. And then this ability is actually fantastic as well. It's if you can sort of set it up to use with Tome, it can be really nice. Can like, you know, with a time snap potion, you can kind of set up to do some silly things with Tome of the Arknight. So, mainly the crown's in here for the Arcane Barrier 1. So that's the equipment. Okay, so now we're going to take a look at the shadow cards or the blood deck cards. So the stuff that you can play from your banish zone. So we got 9, 12, 14, 26, 36. So pretty much half of the deck. So generally most matchups you're going to be playing around that 70 mark. And you know, you might board out one or two of these or whatever. So generally, you're going to be playing about half of your deck can be played from your banish zone, which is definitely what you want. in those later turns, when you've got six soul shackles, the ideal number of blood deck cards to hit is usually about three. So that's kind of what you're aiming for there. You could do some pretty powerful stuff here. So generally, it's about trying to do as many things as you can. You're a go wide deck, right? So you are trying to kind of put pressure on your opponent a whole lot of different ways and not make it easy for them to kind of survive your onslaught or just throw away one or two cards or whatever. Like you want to be hitting them sort of thing. So and then you've got these cards here that allow you to just make massive, incredible turns. So obviously the combo with Riftbind and Seeds of Agony effectively means each seeds except for the blue one will deal two damage, and the blue one will usually deal two damage anyway because it will give plus one to a Riftbind and then it will ping off your Demigod or Snatch or Enlightened Strike or whatever you follow it up with. Generally what you're trying to do a couple of times in the game is sort of play about three of these seeds and ideally even more non-attack reactions, but you know, kind of depends what you've got, and then play a Riftbind. And Riftbind at that point is going to come in for sort of seven or so damage with go again, because your hero ability will have made a soul shackle token to give it go again. Make sure you play all your non-attack actions first, because the hero ability just gives the next shadow or rune blade card you play go again or attack. So it'll just, you know, one of these that already has go again, if you soul shackle and then play this, it'll just give this go again twice. So you want to play out all your non-attack actions, get everything out there, then soul shackle and then slam in a Riftbind from your banish zone. So you know, a lot of people saw this deck and you know, immediately were like, oh well, I just play like 9 Riftbinds and 9 seeds, right? Like, isn't that crazy? Well, it's a little bit greedy. So I've found 5 Riftbinds to be the right number. 9 seeds, definitely. This card is ridiculous. It's exactly what you want to be doing on so many of your turns. Even in the early game, just playing a seeds into a bounding demigod into attacking with the weapon is great to put on a little bit of pressure while you're building up. Siege is just fantastic all the time, and I'm more than happy a lot of the time to leave it in my banish zone and take blood debt for it, because later on it's just going to be so powerful. You don't want to take too much blood debt. I mean, this card isn't worth paying 4 life for, but if you're talking 1 or 2 life, yeah, it's fantastic. So I found sort of 5 Riftbinds. The issue with Riftbind is like you want it because you're going to do a couple of really big Riftbind turns, but on the turns that you're not doing massive turns, like, you know, blue Riftbind, for example, 1 attack, with the 1 non-attack action you're going to play, it's just not worth it. Like, you need to be playing more powerful things that actually make them block with a card. You don't want to be playing 2 Riftbinds every turn or anything like that. So definitely not worth playing the blue ones. And I found, you know, that sort of 5-6 number to be right, but I've settled on 5. I think 5 gives me about the perfect sort of balance there of how often I want to be playing it. Bounding Demigod, fantastic card. 0 resources is perfect. It slips in to so many of your turns. I like the blue one as well, just because I want blues. You know, attacking for 2 on a turn where you weren't planning to do too much, or a turn where you had a free extra action point or whatever that you wouldn't have used otherwise. Very easy to get these guys out of banish, very easy to just play them. Attacking for 4 for 0 is exactly what you want to do. So the red one's fantastic, the blue one's handy, and they block 3, which is important for the early game when you're blocking and setting up. And when you banish them, you can block with your whole hand and then just play a demigod from your banish. Like, it's fine, you know. So they're a very easy card to get out of your banished as well. Same sort of thing for Shadow. You can just play it out of your banished, or it can help you to piece together a massive turn. And when you've just got spare, you know, Seeds of Agonies in your hand or whatever that you don't want to pitch, you can just banish to give this go again and then just play them from banished anyway. So Shadow really helps to kind of filter things through. And another really important part about Shadow of Ursa is that Riftbind, you need to play it from banish to get its effect. So if you have one of these in hand, you can use Shadow from banish to just play this, pop this into your banish zone, and then this is live to play now. So absolutely fantastic there. I love this card. Unhallowed Rites is ideal. The main thing is that through the course of the game, instead of having only 9 Seeds of Agony, now I have 12. Unhallowed almost always popping a Seeds of Agony to the bottom, and just giving you more seeds for that final turn, that late game, you know, sort of stuff when you're going to go off. Allowing you to recycle these for that final turn is exactly what you want to be doing. And then with all of this arcane damage from rune chants, from seeds and everything, obviously Rip Through Reality gets really, really good. Now, this card, I play 2 of it in every matchup, even if they're going to be null ruining a lot of my arcane damage, because just the fact that this is in your banish zone is such a threat for them. If if this is in your banish zone and you've got a couple of seeds or whatever, you can just play 1, play something else with go again from your shackle, and then they really have to prevent the 1 damage from your seeds. You know, they have to pitch a whole card for that, and then you're just not even going to play this. You'll just do the same thing to them next turn. Make them pitch a whole card for your 1 rune chant damage, because they know that if they don't, you're coming in with go again and hitting them so much harder. So the threat of Rip in your banish zone is fantastic as well. Hell from Beyond, fantastic card. I mean, a +3 that only costs 1 card, you know what I mean? Like, the fact that this can be played from banished means that you're, you know, it's only costing usually around about a card, often less than a card, because a lot of the time you'll be pitching blues for it or whatever. So when you sort of think of sort of pump cards like Razor Reflex, or, you know, come to fight or whatever, you know, you're paying a resource and you're paying the card itself. Well, with how you're only paying the resource, because playing it from Banish doesn't actually cost you a card. So this card is a lot better than you know, you might think, just seeing it in a vacuum. Just basically the value that you get from this is huge. And then the fact that, you know, you get to combine this, obviously, with Riftbind, it's effectively plus four. It's any attack action card, so things like Snatch, anything with an on-hit trigger, is huge for this card as well. So you get to, you know, kind of do some pretty cool stuff. Eclipse, oh my gosh. Is this not one of my most favorite cards I've ever played with? It's really, really cool. The fact that you can play it from Banish. The fact that it's just a blue that sits around, gets banished at some point, and then around that point where you have seven soul shackles and you're going in, you know, to sort of seal the deal, or, you know, you need to go for a kill turn, or you're gonna fatigue your deck out. It's quite a lot of the time you will just naturally accidentally play six blood deck cards in those turns anyway, and then you just eclipse. And then they're in trouble. Once you've eclipsed and you've got a 6/6, I mean, you can banish the rest of your deck. It doesn't matter. Between that and the weapon and the other one or two things that you're going to be able to do, usually you can kill them. And especially if they're a light hero with a bunch of soul, and this, you know, the Ursa token is going to come in with go again as well, it can just be silly. Final cards, Seeping, really nice to just have this. Have a one of this in your deck for those late game turns. The fact that this can give Snatch or Enlightened Strike go again, or it can just allow you to do an extra demigod on a turn. It just allows you to get that extra little bit, you know, so that you can be attacking them sort of four times or whatever in a turn. And really, you know, even if they block with their whole hand, they're still taking damage. So this is really good once they start to get low life and they have to block a bit. Really, really good to have this. Great setup card. Just not very good against super aggressive decks, because it might, you know, you might have to sit this in your Banish for a little while and take a little bit of damage off it. So you really want to be the aggressor in that matchup. So this is great for matchups where you are the aggressor. Invert Existence, again, it's a great little finisher card as well, you know, in those games where you get them really low, but you're getting close to fatiguing out and you need to be able to finish them. Having Inverts in your deck just means that you can, you know, ping that last bit of damage, and if they're not, if they don't have two Nullruns out, they're going to take at least one from this and have to pitch a card for the other one. It's not a good time for them. This is the shadow cards, and now we're going to move into kind of the resource cards. Okay, we're going to look at the resource cards here. We're going to look at our blues, because in this deck, blues are specifically important, and it's really cool that our blues do a lot. So we're playing 28 blues, little under half the deck, which is around about where we want to be, because we're going to be pitching them in the early game and then in the late game. Really, we want, you know, if you're playing more than 20 blues, you get to the issue with a lot of decks is if you play too many blues and the games go too long, you get to the late game where you draw hands that are just like three and four blues, which often happens when you're playing, you know, sort of that 20 mark. Well, in this deck, that's exactly what you want to happen. So the great thing about this deck is you have blues that you can utilize throughout the game, but in the end game, you're playing enough of them that you're just going to draw a whole bunch of blues in the late game, and that's when you have, you know, when you're banishing six or seven cards a turn, and you can just pitch your blues and play everything from Banished, and it's all crazy exactly what you want. So all of your blues do like really important things throughout the game as well. So obviously Seeds of Agony, we know we trigger trigger arcane damage. We're hitting harder with Riftbind. Demigod is great. It's a block three that you can just throw out at some point when you've got that extra action point. Plunder Run is fantastic. Putting this card in Arsenal, starting your turn with this, makes it really, really hard for your opponent. If you start off with a Plunder Run, and then, yeah, like everything, it's quite easy to hit with one of your cards because everything's coming in for sort of 4+. You're able to play multiple cards a turn that are 2-card blocks. So it can be very difficult for your opponent to stop you from drawing a card. So Plunder Run is fantastic. +1 and draw a card, and it's a blue, and then that card is going to allow you to do even more things, and it's just things can get quite crazy with this, with starting off with a Plunder Run in place. So exactly what you want. Moravian Skies, really good for making those big turns happen again. A blue that can also make really big turns happen. So it gives the next Runeblade attack go again. So you can do this, play something from your banish zone, and then keep going, you know. Then make a Soul Shackle, play another thing from your banish zone, hit with your weapon as well, whatever, you know. This allows you to just go super wide, which is exactly what your deck wants to do. Tome is very good in this deck, which is great. So we're playing, I think, about 32 non-attack actions and maybe 33 or 34 attack actions. So the stats are really, really close between the two. So Tome of the Arknight hits a surprising number of times. And then throughout the game, you're just wanting to always kind of have Tome in the back of your mind. So when you're doing your pitch, try to pitch attack action, non-attack action, attack action, non-attack action, when you're setting up kind of the bottom of your deck from your pitch zone. If last turn you pitched an attack action, just make sure the next card that goes on the bottom is a non-attack action if you're, you know, deciding between the two cards, and just kind of keep building that throughout the game. And then later on, Tome can quite often just draw you two cards on a turn where two cards are huge for you. And then obviously Ivor Phidia works really well with Tome, but I just works really well in general as well. Like Ivor Phidia is fantastic in this deck because you don't want to be drawing your shadow cards. So when you pitch, the cards that are on the top of your deck are the cards that you're going to be drawing at the end of your turn, right? Those are the cards you're going to be drawing up. So when you see cards that are blood debt, you know, your blood debt red cards that you don't want to be playing from your hand, you can pop those onto the bottom and save them for that late game smash as well. So Eye of Ophidia is perfect for, you know, filtering what you want to draw and what you don't want to draw. Because drawing a red blood deck card is, you know, effectively you're losing out on a whole card because that thing's free if you banish it anyway. So getting to have that later on as a whole free card later on. So Eye of Dividends pays huge dividends later in the game. Eye of Dividends, Eye of Ophidia, that one. We're going to call it Eye of Dividends now. I've already talked about Seeping Shadow and Eclipse. Oh, Eclipse is so good. Time Snap Potion, mainly for the Illusionist Prism matchup. I think I spoke about a little bit earlier in the thing about how this just stops the magnet card, and it's just really good against any of their auras to just pop this, hit their aura, and you still, you know, it closes the chain, you lose your go again or whatever, but you still have an action point. So it's just perfect. You just don't do it with a go again. You can just pop this, play a demigod, blow up their aura, and then start your turn. So perfect for that. All right, now we're gonna have a look at some of the power cards. All right, here is the juice. Here is the power. So yeah, we could do some pretty cool stuff here. So I've already talked about a lot of these blood debt cards, so I'm gonna just kind of pop them to the side. I haven't done that with Eclipse because I don't know. Like I'm so in love with Eclipse. This is a power card. I think this has made every single thing that we've talked about. This is a resource card. It's a card that you can play from banished. It's a power card. It's just everything. Eclipse is my whole world. So Soul Reaping. Again, we're gonna you know, if we're gonna talk about power, let's cut straight to the chase over here. Soul Reaping is ridiculous. So this card allows you, you're never ever paying the 6 for it. like ever. If you're in a spot where you couldn't banish, you know, a card, you put it in your arsenal. Like I just don't know why you would ever pay the six, because you what you can do with this card is that you can banish any card from your hand. It doesn't even have to be a shadow card. Just banish one or more cards from your hand rather than pay Soul Reaping's cost. So you banish a card and you can play this for six. With a soul, if you make a Soul Shackle from chain, it'll have go again. But if they have cards in their soul, it has go again anyway. So against light heroes, if they have multiple cards in their soul and they're not going to be able to get rid of those cards from their souls on the turn that you're attacking, you can just freely attack with this and know that it's going to have go again anyway. And then the other cool thing is if you're banishing shadow cards with this, you also get a resource for each shadow card that you banish. So if you have a hand where you have, like, you know, multiple of these or whatever, you can just banish them all. You know, you can just use this ability to banish them all, gain the resources, and then use those resources to just play them. So Soul Reaping, you know, there's a reason that you're only allowed one of each of these cards. They are both silly powerful cards. So yeah, Soul Reaping does everything that you want to be doing in the stack. You're hitting hard, you're banishing your blood deck cards, you're getting extra resources to be able to do things, and it doesn't cost anything. It's just free. Free as a bird. Let's look at some of these power cards. So these cards here all give things go again, which is exactly what you want to be doing. So Shadow Puppetry, just absurd card. You can give Snatch go again. You can give Enlightened Strike go again. You can give anything go again. So any attack, you know, you can use this. It buffs Riftbind. You can use this to play any of these things and then carry on with your turn. And then it's the extra cherry on the top is more than just a cherry as well. Like, that is very plus one, and if it hits, you get to banish. So half of the cards in your deck are, you know, sort of plus a card when you banish, right? Half of the cards in your deck you can play from your banish zone. So half the time, this is also going to kind of net you an extra card as well. So yeah, just an incredibly powerful Majestic. Does everything that you want to do there. You know, plus one, go again, plus netting a bit of a card, and all for zero cost. Like, it's just, you know, some of these shadow cards are just silly. Razor obviously combos really, really well with Snatch, but can combo with any attack action to just allow you to keep going on the chain. It's really hard for them to, you know, this format, much unlike the last, doesn't play, you know, people are not going to be able to play as many defense reactions and as many ways to kind of block up and be safe against a Razor as before, because the format's so proactive now that if you're just playing a bunch of defense reactions, you're going to fall behind. In the last format, you know, you could play these dash control decks where you had a whole lot of defense reactions. You could keep yourself on high life, give yourself a lot of time to set up. In this format, I feel if you try to do that, you're just going to get overrun. These go wide decks like this are just going to laugh at defense reactions. So I don't think that they're really going to be able to stop Razor as well as you've been able to in the past as well. And then, you know, combining again, the fact that Plunder Run draws a card on hit with things like Razor and things like Art of War, where you can kind of catch them out here. And the great thing about Art of War in this deck is everything about Art of War. Like, the fact that you banish cards that you're going to play anyway, so that's free, and then drawing two cards from that. The fact that you can attack with something. A lot of the time with Art of War and a lot of decks, you needed to start your turn with Art of War because you needed to get the go again, and you needed to kind of draw the cards to be able to do things. So, you know, you kind of lost the surprise factor from the plus one. In this deck, you very rarely have to start your turn with Art of War. Often, because of the Soul Shackle, you can make a Soul Shackle, get go again anyway, and then just play something from banish. And then if they block, you can surprise with an Art of War, give plus one, and draw two cards, or give plus one and your next thing has go again, so you can keep going wide, or whatever, you know. Yeah, it can be pretty powerful there. Meet and greet, obviously great. If your opponent doesn't have a null rune, or they're not a deck with heavy blues that are going to be able to kind of stop all of your arcane damage, just four attack go again with an on hit trigger for, you know, effectively an extra damage is just huge for one card. Like, that's exactly what you want to be doing. So you'd be boarding this in against any sort of red line decks, any sort of aggro decks, things that don't play a whole lot of blues and have spare cards to be able to stop and prevent your null rune damage. And yeah, just helps you to kind of keep hitting harder. But yeah, you know, and Leiden Strike, I've played in Leiden Strike in a lot of decks. And I was, you know, I was sort of the one, last format that was saying, hey, this card's starting to get a lot worse. You know, it's not, it doesn't provide the flexibility that you need. It provides flexibility, but you need so much less of that nowadays that we have access to so many more cards, and the classes have so many options. So in Leiden Strike, still, while a good card, you know, has gotten slightly worse, but not in this deck. This deck plays in Leiden Strike so much better than any deck that I've ever played it in. I legitimately think in Leiden Strike is better in this deck than it even was in Katsu or Aura or anything, because there's just so many ways to get go again with Shadow Puppetry, with Art of War, with Razor. Like, and in Leiden Strike with go again is very powerful, and Leiden Strike with Plunder Runs is just crazy. You know, you can just give itself go again and just keep going, and Leiden Strike at the end of a chain after you've already attacked them a bunch with go again and stuff, and then also being able to put your shadow cards to the bottom of your deck so that you can just banish them later on and play them is just so free. So yeah, the cost to play in Leiden Strike is so much less in this deck because you want to put these cards to the bottom because you're just going to get to play them again for free later on because of it. And then all of the effects of in Leiden Strike are just huge. So fantastic in Leiden Strike deck, definitely what you want to be doing. Yeah, so I mean, the only cards I think we haven't spoken about, or the only card actually, is Gorgonian Tome. So this is just another sort of free card that you might as well play. So this is a card that was great in the old Runeblade deck, so that you could turn on the ability to make rune chants from your hero, from Viscerite. But in this deck, it's kind of the same sort of thing. So it allows you to turn on this card, Unhallowed Rites, just for free. So if you're blocking in the early game, a lot of the time you can play Tome. More than half the time, you'll draw a non-red card. But even a red card can allow you to play this. And if you draw, you know, if you Gorgonian Tome and draw a blue card, you're going to be able to Soul Shackle, play this, use its effect, has go again, and come in with the weapon afterwards as well. So Tome, and on top of that, just with your Rift Binds here, you know, it's an extra damage. It's just a free extra damage. So the drawback of not being able to block with it in a deck like this isn't huge anyway. And the fact that it just, you know, kind of turns your stuff on at the start of a turn. And also, you know, not even to mention, it turns the weapon on. So, you know, even in those spots in the early game when you're just building up Soul Shackles, if you have to block with the rest of your hand, you know, you block with three cards, you just keep Tome in hand, you can start your turn with Tome. And then as long as you draw a non-red card, which you're over 50% to, you can pitch that and come in for four with the weapon, and put them in a spot where they have to block, usually within a card and an equipment or two cards. Otherwise, you just net so much value out of a turn where you also just blocked them with three cards. So yeah, just perfect little free card that you might as well play, and kind of does everything that you want to do. Yeah, so I think that's pretty much it. Eclipse, play your eclipses. Do some cool stuff with Eclipse. Yeah, let's go back to the couches and kind of talk a little bit more on this deck.
All right, that's a deck.
That is a deck.
Yeah.
I think by now they probably have realized the card that you talked about a lot of.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Eclipse?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm a bit of a fan of that card, as you can tell. So, yeah, I really want to be playing that card, you know, making my Ursa a few times throughout the event. I'm sure it'll bring an ear-to-ear smile every time I do it. Yeah.
I'd like to, obviously, we're going into an event, Classic Construct. You've picked Chain. Obviously, this early in the format, generally, you're going off. There isn't a metagame set. You don't know what everybody's going to play. You're just playing the deck that you think is the best, in theory.
Yes and no. So I'm playing the deck that I think is the best at the start of a metagame as well. So I think Chain is a deck that does a whole lot of crazy things that's quite hard to play against and plan against. And, you know, sideboard and know how to navigate against at the start. So while I think this deck is completely bonkers and I think it's going to do really well, I'm hugely confident in this deck. I don't think that's going to be the case in 2 months' time. I think that it is quite easy to sideboard against Chain and kind of find ways to break that matchup. And I've been talking with Kale McCreef, who's, you know, dead set on Guardian, still wants to play Guardian. You know the guy.
Kale, your hero is talentless. Your hero has no talent. No, it's time to move on to another one.
He still wants to play Bravo. He's in love with that hero. It's all right, I get it. So I've been talking with him and coming up with ways. And I think the build that we've sort of come up with actually beats Chain. I think we've actually found a way to beat Chain with Bravo. Whereas before, I played a game with Kale, Chain versus Bravo, and I absolutely wiped the floor with them. Like, it was, you know, it didn't really seem that humble close. Well, Bravo is a talentless hero, as you said, and the deck's quite good. But then we made a bunch of changes, and we tried to specifically target what Chain was trying to do, and I think we came up with something that beats it. Do I think people are going to have that this weekend? No, I don't think people have had enough time to test against Chain to realize that just yet.
And it's obviously, it's always like this, like multi-complex rock, paper, scissors, where if Bravo can't beat the Prism list that ends up being the most popular, then Bravo becomes just not a great choice for the metagame. Exactly. And it's just this totally shifting. But this weekend, you're bringing
right
in Chain.
Right now, Chain is the nut. And even when decks figure out how to sideboard again, it's not going to make Chain unplayable. Those matchups are still going to be pretty even because the power of Chain is just so high.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, naturally Chain is just going to be an incredible deck for this format. Well, and I think, you know, I'm really excited to see how Chain evolves and develops as well. So obviously, you know, I've given my starter list and what I'm playing in this big tournament and what I've come to. But I really want people watching this video to try a few other things and develop the list a little bit more and see what they come to as well. Because I'm excited as to, you know, how Chain will develop for a meta game that starts trying to attack it as well, which I expect is going to happen pretty soon.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's dive into a couple of the cards specifically that were in the list. Obviously, you talked a ton of in-depth about the deck itself and the card choices and why and when and what. But obviously, we touched on it before, Eclipse. The funny thing, we were talking off camera about this, but when I saw that spoiler, I skimmed over the fact that it could itself could be played from Banished.
Yeah.
Like, in my mind, I'm like, this... Oh,
it doesn't have Blood Debt, so it can't be played from Banished.
From Banished. And also, I think deep in the reason, my subconscious, I was like, if that could be played from Banish,
it would just be too powerful. It's kind of like that other shadow card that's like, well, you can't just pitch any card to make it cost 0 rather than 6, right? That would be too good. Maybe it's pitch and each card makes it cost 1 less or something, right?
Yeah.
Like, Sol Reaping. No. Sol Reaping is that powerful and Eclipse is that powerful.
Okay, but obviously, what I want to touch on more specifically, Eclipse is busted. Instant free, can play it from Banished, obviously really, really good. But what it makes is the Ursa, the Sol Reaping token. Now, there's been a lot of chat about like how good that token actually is. Obviously, it can get go again if it's Statue of the Light Hero, but how vulnerable it is in terms of on the opponent's turn just to be attacked.
Please attack it. Six life. I just got six life for nothing. Like, that's huge. Like, that is good enough for me. Getting six life in this game is just huge. You know, that's two sigils for nothing, for no cards. You didn't trade any cards for that. You played the Eclipse from Banished. It was free. That is such a massive advantage, you know, getting six life. And then, you know, a lot of the time you can, because of the way that chain works and there's so much go-agains and stuff, a lot of the time, you know, and you've got Snapdragon, a lot of the time you can attack with it the turn that you've played it as well. So you can Eclipse, you know, you can, basically play some seeds, you know, get go again with the Soul Shackle, play a Riftbind or something, and then maybe even play something else, crack your Snapdragons to give that go again, Eclipse, bring in the six, you know, the six power Ursa, attack them with that, and then they, you know, it's attacked for six, and now they still have to deal six back to kill it. You know, how big of an advantage is that?
So that's the whole point. This card is, if you only get one attack in it, that fine, because that means that they've had to trade X resources.
Well, they've had to trade two cards and then six damage back. It's so hard.
And specifically, that's a constructed, I guess, if they choose to attack you and you get to just
keep attacking with them, then that's great too. Well, I mean, if they choose to attack you, you don't need the cards in your hand as much if you've got the Ursa token, so you can just block. It's fine. Like, if you have to block, you just block. You've got an Ursa token to attack them back with, so then, you know, you just pitch the one blue in your hand, play something from Banish with a Soul Shackle, give it go again, then Ursa token after that, or Ursa token into weapon or whatever.
And what I actually love, which has nothing to do with in terms of how it plays out in the game, but in so many card games, generally the heralded like card of the set, right? Like, so in this instance, Chain as a hero, James himself has talked about how he was one of the original heroes
built. It was one of his first.
It was always designed to be a shadow hero and have this ability with like dealing in this banished area, this banished zone. But very often the namesake cards of sets don't actually tend to be as good in practice and competitive environment. Eclipse is one of those namesake cards, right? It's the legendary chain specialization. And I just think it's awesome that a card like that is actually so good.
Is competitively viable as well, or like massively competitively viable.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like, you're just going to see it at tables. You want the namesake cards of these sets to be thrown around kitchen tables and at tournaments and to have them see play.
To me, Eclipse is like one of the most powerful cards in the game.
Yeah.
Well, for what you get from it, the fact that it doesn't cost you a card to play it, it's free, it makes a 6/6. Also, throughout having it in your deck isn't a huge disadvantage because it just pitches three anyway. Like, in terms of what you get out of a card, that's way up there.
And another card I wanted to just touch on, because I think it was the card that probably had the most hype when the spoilers started coming out from Blood Debt, but in combination with Art of War, which is a card we saw out of Arcane Rising. Obviously, that idea of whenever we've played Art of War in the past, it's been a disadvantage to banish a card, right? That's a card that you can no longer play. But in this deck,
You're trading a card and the use of the Art of War and the resource that it cost it for two more cards, right?
Yeah.
And then you get the thing. Now, you're not really trading a card, you're just getting two more cards. Like, you may be trading the resource that red card could have pitched for, you know?
Yeah.
Like, the thing is these cards in your hand, so many of them are redundant anyway, that they're kind of just a pitch red. So the fact that, you know, you're getting to trade that for two cards is huge. Art of War is so powerful.
Yeah. And I think, like you touched on in the deck tech, it doesn't just play out how it used to either, where at the start of your turn, Art of War plus one and your opponents see it coming.
Yeah.
The fact that it is an instant that you have so just readily available to any amount of go again as you want because of Chain's hero ability, and you actively want to be making Soul Shackles. The fact that Art of War becomes this surprise,
you know,
this
how
instant
powerful it is to start off with a plunder run and then play shadow puppetry and come in with a snatch. I mean, this is magical Christmas time, but like if you have an Art of War there and like, you know, they're like, oh, well, I have to block up because otherwise this turn is just too powerful. You know how crazy the plus one is when it gets through and then you draw two more cards and you're going to be doing all this other stuff this turn?
Yeah. Well, that's another card we should touch on with Plunder Run, because that was a card that you were very specifically, as soon as you saw Riftbind,
yeah,
you were like, this card's going to be busted in combination with Plunder Run.
This card goes with Plunder Run, yeah.
And that was before, I think, the hero had been spoiled, or was it? I think maybe it was just in tandem. I can't remember.
I'm pretty sure the hero had been spoiled. But yeah, Riftbind got spoiled, and I was like, well, yeah.
Yeah. And it just, I think it just going to miss Plunder Run.
Yeah.
In response to the spoiler.
Yeah, Nick was really big on that. As soon as Riftbind was spoiled, we were both just fizzing off about, oh, well, you just play plunder runs and nimblisms and all of these pump spells, and I'm sure you can just make this thing massive and ridiculous. And turns out you can. Yeah. I mean, you don't even need to play nimblism and the bad cards, but turns out you can, you know. But I've gone for a few iterations of this deck. There was a list where I played Nimblism at the start. There was a list where I played Belittle and Minnowism and stuff like that as well. But this is...
Wait, hold on.
What?
And this wasn't just your sealed practice deck?
No, no, this is...
Because I know we've got the calling come up, so we've been playing a bit of sealed. I just want to make sure we're not, like, crossing
No, format. this was high-level competitive testing for a winner case of crew tournament deck building going on here. Okay.
And coming at you with Belittle Minnowism. I guess it didn't make the deck,
No. But it was close, to be honest. Like, playing a Belittle and being able to search up a blue Minnowism for an extra pitch, or being able to search up a red Minnowism for the
plus three.
Yeah, for the Riftbind, or for you know, whatever else you were going to play that turn. But Minnowism just didn't quite, the red one just wasn't quite good enough, in the fact that like it doesn't pump Snatch, it doesn't pump Inline and Strike, it doesn't pump a lot of cards, you know, Rip Through Reality, etc. So it's very restricted. So it was nice to be able to go three attack with go again, search up a blue pitch. But outside of that, you know, it wasn't great.
How did you find like with the shuffle as well on that? Because this was a point of tension I had when I was trying to make Viscerai work, is that actively I was, as you mentioned in the video, to make Tome of the Arcanite work, which you would expect to be good in a Rimblade, it's one of the supers, like that you actively want to pitch,
you non-attack, attack, non-attack.
But then I would get to a point where I want to become the Arcanite.
Yeah, and shuffle.
And now I'm shuffling all that hard work away, and it's just totally randomizing.
Yeah, so there's negatives and positives to it. Sometimes, you know, because you're putting a lot of blood deck cards on the bottom of your deck with things like Inline and Strike and whatnot, like, you know, you kind of do want to shuffle those cards in, but at the same time, you know, you are the whole game, you are trying to go non-attack, attack, non-attack, and it makes Tome very good in the late game. And the fact that you... want a whole lot of blues to clump together at the end as well also means that you don't want to shuffle that much. So there's positives and negatives, because obviously getting more blues throughout the game is nice as well. So it is really, really mixed, but ultimately the way I would rather play out the game is to try to stack for Tome and stack a bunch of blues for my final couple turns. So ultimately I'd prefer not to shuffle my deck.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's been, you know, it's going to be interesting to see how the deck plays out. Like, I have loved Chain from the get-go because I just like Runeblade.
I mean, what I can say is at night, at bed, you know, if you've seen, what's that chess TV show?
I don't know what you watch at night, mate, in bed, it's like...
anyway, we're that kind of chess prodigy, you know, she lies in bed and on the roof.
Like, Queen's Gambit.
Queen's Gambit, there you go. See, you knew, I got that. She lies in bed and plays chess, you know, that's been me the last few nights, like lying in bed thinking about like my chain interactions and stuff. Mm-hmm. And like, I mean, not in this like crazy genius sort of like pitch, you know, off the ceiling or whatever, but yeah, just like sitting there, you know, thinking, oh, and then I can go again this, and I can do this and put the seeds back on my bottom, and then, you know, kind of the different combinations of things and stuff. And that's been keeping me up at night. That's been, it's been cool though. It's been really, you know, just so many moments of, man, there is so much I could do with this hero. There's so much I can do in a game of Flesh and Blood with this deck. It's so cool.
Yeah, I'm really excited to see how it plays out. I've also, you know, I've been trying to play Prism and Bolton, and I haven't played too much Leviah, but
I thought you were going to be a chain man.
No, I am, but you were
Rune Blade before it. You know,
before it was good.
Before it was good.
Like, yeah, I'm definitely a chain man.
Don't turn away from it now. Now's the point where you can win games playing it.
But you know, I like to just dabble. I always find that playing as Prism and playing the Prism deck always gives you way better insight than just playing against it, right?
Yeah.
You actively want to know, okay, when I'm playing this deck, what am I wanting to set up? How am I playing in these situations? What do I feel, you know, is best? So it's like good to be able to play both sides, but I'm still a chain man. So I'm actively excited to see how the deck performs, how you go on the weekend. One question, are Dice Jar doing coverage?
Yes. Yes. They're doing a full stream. So I think you can look them up. I'm sure they have a YouTube channel.
Yeah. So they
definitely have a Facebook, which they'll be advertising on that, but they are streaming it. They're streaming it live. They've got commentators as well. I think Jordan Nelson Fussell is on the thing. He's controversial, but he's very entertaining. I mean, Jordan ruffles up some feathers and he rubs people the wrong way and stuff. And you know, but he's also incredibly, like, he's hilarious.
Yeah,
he's really, really entertaining.
Really good.
I enjoy his content. So anything where he's going to be commentating, I'll be going back and watching.
I love when he chucks in a basketball reference too.
Yeah,
you know, every now and again, just a light one, you know.
Before we wrap up though, I wanted to just quickly touch on the matchups as well, so that people are kind of a little.
Well, wait, what I was going to say is that obviously this video will be coming out after the event.
Yeah,
we'll be going live after the event, so you guys obviously won't be able to watch it live, but they do have a YouTube channel, so you will be able to go back and rewatch that.
Watch the games I play.
The things. So
you can see me
So yeah, Dice Jar. They have a YouTube. You'll be able to search them.
That's if I make it on coverage. I mean, this deck's mostly theory. I could turn up massively confident, thinking I've broken the format.
That's true.
And then just go 0-3.
We better ask Greg to see if he can get you in round one.
Fair enough. But yeah, I think people are also quite interested in the matchups and what they're kind of expecting. So firstly, if we look at the kind of last format decks, Dash is a walk in the park. I don't think this deck can lose to Dash. I just don't think it happens. Like, the fact this deck is a setup deck that is very good against decks that aren't using on-hit effects. Right. Yeah. So if you can kind of choose when you take damage from them and when you don't, this deck's amazing at that, because you can block in the early, try to keep your life total high. And the Dash decks are generally quite slow in the early game as well. So you're going to get to that later point where you have 6 and 7 Soul Shackles, and then you're just going to hammer them with way more than they can ever put up with. So they're not going to be able
to
sit around.
Dash is another talentless hero.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to jump in tournaments with Dash anymore, man.
But for those people that don't want to jump in tournaments with Dash anymore, that were sick of playing against Dash last format, pick up this chain deck. You will destroy them. Yeah. Like, I don't think they're not going to be able to get these high octane turns off, because they're going to have to pay 20 plus life to do it by taking your whole turn beforehand, and then you can just take it back and hit them harder. Like, whatever. Yeah. So Dash is going to be a walk in the park. I think at the moment, all the Guardian lists out there are very easy. I think this deck destroys the Guardian lists that are out there. Guardian can change, and I think attack chain quite well, but the decks that people are on at the moment, I think chain is going to be heavily favored versus Guardian. Dorimpia is a little bit closer, just because the Iron Song Determination is quite good against you. Those Iron Song turns, you're in the early game, you want to just be blocking with a bunch of cards, and they can kind of get you with a Twin Blade, or force that you to not be able to do that with the Iron Song. So they can kind of get their, you know, supremacy turns and stuff and get ahead. But if you swing momentum in that matchup, they're not going to be able to get it back. I think that matchup is still slightly favored, but not as much as the other matchups.
I think it's close to
50-50.
More so than the Dash is a hero that I could see people bringing to the table probably a little bit more now.
Yeah. So I think that's the only talentless hero that I'm fussed about.
Yeah.
I don't think Reinar's going to be able to, you know, the fact that they banish all your cards and then you can still use them. Like, I think you're just going to hit harder than them. Like, you know, if Reinar manages to get the right hands early where they can banish all your cards on the turns that you want to block, they can hit you pretty hard.
Intimidate them.
But I think ultimately they're not going to be able to deal 40 damage like in the first few turns. So you are going to get to those late game turns and then they're not just going to be able to take everything. Yep. Like, I think ultimately you're going to have enough life and the chest piece giving you the extra six there that you are going to be able to get through what they're coming at you with. And I think ultimately you're going to beat Reinar. Against the older heroes, I mean, things like Viscera, you're just a better deck. You're just the better Runeblade deck. It's not even going to be close.
Yeah.
R.I.P.
Viscera.
Bless her soul, Azalea is never going to be able to keep up with you.
Is Azalea really a hero?
Yeah.
It wasn't good in the old meta game. It's definitely not.
Definitely not going to keep up with Chain. Kano could be quite hard. Kano is probably your worst matchup, just because you're not really preparing yourself for it. And I think that that's correct at this point, because Kano, I don't think, is going to be able to beat anything else. I don't think Kano is going to have a show against Illusionist. I think Prison is going to destroy her. I think Leviah is going to destroy her, Shadowbrew. Yeah. And I think Bolton's going to destroy Kano. He's really just going to struggle against everything. So I don't mind having that as the bad matchup.
We're obviously talking about Classic Constructor.
Yeah.
Specifically talking about Classic
Constructor. Yeah. Well, we're talking, we showed a Classic deck today, right?
Yeah.
In terms of the newer decks, Leviah, I think, is a fantastic matchup for Chain. When they come in the early game with big things, you get to just block two or three cards on them and not care. And they're a deck that can't force the issue too fast and too, you know, they're a bit of a setup deck as well. So I don't think that they're going to be able to hit you hard enough in the early, that they're going to be able to come through for enough in the late. Like, any deck where you're able to get to that 6-7 Soul Shackles with a decent life buffer, I think you're very favored against. So, Leviah, I'm pretty sure you're in that position. You can get to that life buffer and then just take their hits and come back and swing momentum and come back with everything. And they're not going to just be able to take that turn after turn. So I think you're going to kind of smash them a bit there. I originally thought that Illusionist might be hard, just because you don't have any six powers whatever to stop their illusions. Nothing in your deck is six power. You don't even play any sideboard. I did have Command and Conquer in there at the start and I hated it. I cut that. It was no good in the deck. It didn't flow with what you wanted to do. You wanted to sideboard it out in every matchup except for Illusionist. And I actually found the Illusionist matchup to be very favored. So the Illusionist is the one thing I've tested a little bit against. I found it to be a very favorable matchup. But it is a little bit annoying in that you can't stop their illusions very well and in that they make Soul Shackle tokens that eat up your arcane damage.
Yeah.
So that can be a little bit annoying, but generally, you know, it's the same plan. You can just block their illusions in the early game and then you just take them in the late game. Whatever. They can make spectral shields, they can have things in their soul, they can do all of that sort of stuff. You're just going to hit them harder. Like, they're not going to be able to deal with what you're bringing in the late game. Like, and you know, things like Magnet and stuff, if you get a single time snap potion out, they are in trouble with those auras, because those auras don't block when you're coming in for 20 something damage. Those auras don't block, and if they play it and you can just pop a time snap and chuck a zero cost from banish at it, you know.
How good is it the Parable of Humility, so the -1? It's going to be pretty good, right? But then you just have the option to attack it first.
Yeah. If you have a time snap potion in play, you just attack that and then do your turn. Otherwise, it's pretty decent. Again, it costs 4 resources to play. That's you know, that means it's 2 resource cards and that they're not blocking with, you know? Yeah. And you're going to hit them pretty hard for that. You're going to make them pay a big cost. So I found Illusionist to just really struggle against chain, to kind of get its stuff going. It's a little bit too slow. And then Bolton, I think, is reasonably even. So the decks that you struggle against are more the aggressive decks. Bolton can be quite aggressive, yeah. And it can put you under a bit of pressure while it sets up. So I think the Bolton matchup is very even. Both decks are kind of doing the same sort of thing, and they're both trying to pressure each other a little bit and trying to set up a little bit and then trying to do really big turns against each other. So I think that is going to, yeah, just going to kind of come down to draws and the point of the game. And, you know, if they kind of end up with dud turns or anything like that, then you're going to get put way ahead. And if you don't hit the right banish cards when you're set up, they're going to be able to grab the momentum from you. So I think that matchup is going to be very 50-50.
Yeah. Okay.
Have we covered all of them? We've pretty much covered all of them.
Yeah. But obviously, this is all just theory crafted at this point. This is the first classic constructed tournament that you played in with these heroes. Like, I guess we're going to know a little bit more about the matchups and how they play out and how people are building the decks and
all of that. So I mean, at this point, Nick and I have theory crafted the deck a lot. We have not played a single game with each other with the deck, or at least not this version. We actually printed off a bunch of proxies when spoiler season was going, and we played a couple of games there with chain, but the deck was very different because not all the cards have been spoiled.
So
we haven't actually played any games. I played a couple of games at an armory versus Kale and a couple of other guys. And then Rohan's played a few games and reported back findings from that. So we are kind of going into this with a lot of theory and not a lot of practice. Ultimately it all clicks. I think it all clicks. I think the theory is pretty on point. I'm very confident the deck's gonna be a powerhouse.
Okay. Well, we look forward to seeing how it plays out. I'll definitely be watching some of the coverage back.
Yeah, you can laugh at me at the next MAB with Matt when I went 0-3 and the wheels just fell completely off and I got it all wrong.
Theory crafting isn't quite what it's made out to be, and that you need to actually sit down and play games. Good luck over the weekend.
Yeah, thank you.
Like I said, I'll definitely be watching some coverage where I can.
Yep.
I'm excited to see the new heroes and what's going to be in store.
It's going
to
be a battle.
I have this feeling like we could be surprised. Like, we've joked about heroes being talentless, and maybe they bring something else with an old hero that kind of like gets in there early, or there is just a really refined Prism or Bolton list.
Maybe I'll eat my words and some other new dash deck will come out and dominate the format.
Who knows? But I'm super looking forward to it. Thank you guys for joining us. I hope you guys enjoyed the deck tech and the breakdown. Until next time.
Cool. We'll see you later. Thanks, guys.
Catch you guys.